Hello everyone, I'm your host Kaustubh Pawar, and today in this fifth session of GPAT online session series, we are going to learn about clinical trials. It is a part of pharmacology as well as clinical pharmacy from GPAT perspective. In GPAT syllabus, clinical trial topic has been mentioned in both pharmacology, general pharmacological section, as well as in the clinical trial subject. So we will see first various phases of clinical trials, its significance. Then we will move to different types of drug applications, because clinical trials are directly related to the various types of drug application, that is ANDA, IND, then NDA, which is new drug or generic drug or investigational drug. So that is a part of pharmaceutics. Then we will see new drug application concept. What are new drugs, which drugs are called as a new drugs and how they are introduced, which is a part of a biopharmaceutics from GPAT perspective. In GPAT syllabus, this ANDA application has been mentioned in your biopharmaceutical syllabus. Then we will move to ANDA, which is a generic, also called a generic drugs, and see the importance of bioequivalence and how the bioequivalence tests are carried out, which is also a part of biopharmaceutics. And at the end, we are going to see few important definitions like bioequivalence, pharmaceutical equivalence, therapeutic equivalence, and so on, which is also a part of biopharmaceutics. So in this fifth session, we are going to cover clinical trials, cology, clinical pharmacy, pharmaceutics, types of drug applications, and biopharmaceutics. So let's start with our fifth session. So in this session, as I mentioned, we are going to see clinical trials. So as we all know, clinical trials are broadly classified into four phases, which are compulsory to be qualified and to be complied by according to the USFDA or any regulatory body. So the phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4, and there is a phase 0, which is also called as a microdosing studies, which is carried out before phase 1, but it is not a mandatory by FDA. And that's why we will see that phase 0 later on. So start with the phase 1, which is the initial phase of clinical trials. So after completing the animal trial study, any drug, any new drug or an investigational drug moves to the phase 1 clinical trial. So the phase 1 clinical trial is also called as human pharmacology and safety study. So basically, in this phase 1 study, the new drug is tested on healthy volunteers. So these are not patients, these are healthy human volunteers around in the range of 20 to 100. These number can vary depending upon the studies, but around 2200 human healthy volunteers are taken, and that new drug has been tested on these healthy volunteers. Now, how this study is conducted? This study is an open label. There is no blinding. It means that both the patients and the doctor, the physicians who conduct the test, both knows which drug they are administering, and the patients know which drug they are taking. So that is means it is an open label. There is no blind. Both the parties, patients as well as the physicians or the doctors, know which drug is being administered. And this is the how the tests are conducted of phase 1. Now, what the purpose of this phase 1? So phase 1 clinical trials are important to know the maximum tolerable dose. That is how much dose we can administer of that drug to a person that will be safe. And that's why here we try to identify the safety and tolerability limit. So we have to know for any clinical trials from GPAT perspective as well as for your future, you have to know four things. First one, what is the name of a phase one? So phase one is a human pharmacology and safety studies. They are conducted on healthy volunteers, about 2200. And they're open label. That means both the parties knows which drug is being administered and what is the purpose of the phase 1 trials. Phase 1 trials are used to study the maximum tolerable dose. That is also called as MTD. So here safety and tolerability aspects are measured and analyzed of any new drug. Now, after qualifying, after complying all the regulations and after qualifying the phase 1, the new drug application. So here the first one is the NDA, which is a new drug application, moves to phase 1 after animal studies. After completing phase 1, that new drug application moves to phase 2, which is the second phase of clinical trial. In phase 2, it is called as a therapeutic exploratory phase. In this, the patients are tested. So the drug is tested on the patients, So here around 100 to 150 patients are taken and that new drug application is tested to know the therapeutic efficacy. Now, how these tests are conducted? These tests are conducted in a single blind fashion as well as control blind. So now what is a single blind fashion? In a single blind manner, matlab ki physicians or the doctors knows which drug is being administered, but the patients doesn't know which drug is being administered. It is called a single blind. One party is blind. So that is a single blind control. Then what is the purpose of therapeutic exploratory? So what is the purpose of phase two? So phase two is used to establish the therapeutic efficacy. Here, for the first time, the new drug application or the new drug is being tested on the patient. And that's why we try to know whether that drug is effective or not. So here therapeutic efficacy is tested. After knowing the therapeutic efficacy, we try to establish the dose range. We try to know the what's the dose, minimum dose and the maximum dose of that drug which can be administered, and that dose can show the therapeutic efficacy. And at the end, we try to finalize the ceiling effect. Ceiling effect matlab kya? At the maximum dose, a maximum three consecutive dose which gives us the same effect, it is called as a ceiling effect, same efficacy. So we try to find out the ceiling effect. So that is the significance and the purpose of the therapeutic exploratory, that is phase two. Now after phase two, the new drug application moves to phase three. So after completing phase two, the new drug application is moving to phase three. Phase three is the last phase. After qualifying the phase three, the new drug application has been approved. So always remember, phase three is the stage after, if the new drug application qualifies the phase three, new drug application is been approved by the regulatory bodies. Now the phase three is also called as therapeutic confirmatory phase, in which now in like phase two, it is therapeutic exploratory, where we are trying to study the therapeutic efficacy, whether it is effective or not. After knowing that that drug is effective, in phase three, we confirm that that drug is effective on a large population. So up to 5,000 patients from severe centers across the nation, this clinical trial of phase three occurs. Around 5,000 patients has been tested. It is a heterogeneous population to know that it's sure, to become sure that the therapeutic, that new drug will be therapeutic effective, to confirm that on a large patient group. So now how the clinical trial tests are conducted. So in phase three, it is a double blind randomized control manner. Double blind matlab both the parties, the patient as well as the physician or the doctors who conduct the tests, both the parties don't know whether which drug is being administered, whether it is a drug or whether it is a placebo. That's why the manipulations can be limited and we get the true and accurate results. So that is a double blind fashion or double blind manner. So what's the significance of the therapeutic confirmatory phase? So in a phase three, it is as the names itself suggests, to confirm the therapeutic efficacy. After confirming the therapeutic efficacy, we have to establish the value of drug in relation to the existing therapy. So we have to know how effective this new drug will be as compared to the current ongoing or well established drug therapy. So that is also analyzed in the phase three. So this is the significance of phase one, phase two, phase three. Now after qualifying the phase three, the new drug application is approved and then it moves to the phase four, where the drug is, after when the drug is marketed, it is available in the open market. Then the phase four clinical trial starts, and in here it is also called as post-marketing surveillance. And here the role of pharmacovigilance department comes in, where we have to know how whether there are any adverse drug reactions or adverse drug effects of these new drugs, and especially on a groups like children, pregnant ladies, and etc., which can be tested on a large patients across the nation after drug is being marketed. So this is the whole summary of the clinical trials, important points of clinical trials. Now let's see what is the meaning of phase zero clinical trial. Phase zero clinical trial is also called as microdosing studies. This is done prior to phase one after qualifying the animal studies. industries have a chance to do a phase zero clinical trial. In phase zero, they opt for a healthy volunteer, very small number, about 1 to 10 healthy volunteers, and they give this drug in a very minute dose, which is around 1/100th of the human dose, or about maximum 100 microgram, to know the pharmacokinetics and whether the new drug will qualify the phase one or not. So that is analyzed in microdosing studies, which is also called as phase zero studies. So therefore, phase zero is not mandatory by FDA, but companies opt for these phase zero studies to know whether the new drug will qualify all the clinical trials or not. So that's the significance. In phase zero, it is used to analyze the pharmacokinetics of the, that is ADME, of the new drug. So this is a very important slide with respect to your GPAT as well as your NIPER or any other competitive exam, because in GPAT at least every year they try to ask one question from clinical trials. We will see the list of questions which were asked in previous exam papers. So the first question we will go from GPAT 2020, in this year only, in GPAT 2020, there was question on clinical trial. Question was like this: identify the phase of clinical trial having following features. A, trial is conducted on about 3,000 patients. Purpose of trial is therapeutic confirmation. Safety and tolerability is evaluated on a wide scale. And D, completion of trial is followed by new drug application. So the correct answer is, which is the clinical trial phase which shows all the four options, is the phase three. So as phase three clinical trial, in the phase three, trial is conducted on about 3,000 patients. There is a therapeutic confirmation is done, as well as safety tolerability is assessed on a wide scale. And after completion of phase three, the new drug application is been approved. So that's why the correct answer is phase three. Now we will move to the next question. In GPAT 2018 also, there was question on clinical trials. And the question was like this: the number of subjects required in phase one clinical trials are. It is a pretty easy question. As we saw in the table, the correct answer is 20 to 100. And as the phase increases, the number of patients increases. So that is the GPAT 2018 question. Now in GPAT 2017 question, there was also one question from clinical trial, and the question was related to phase zero. Phase zero study means, so phase zero study means the correct answer is first in human microdosing studies. So it is also called as a microdosing studies. In vitro studies are done prior to clinical trials and animal studies. Part one studies of clinical trial is the wrong answer. So the correct answer is first in human microdosing studies. Then in GPAT 2016 also, there were two questions from the same concept, the concept of clinical trials. The clinical trial is being conducted with 1500 volunteers with mace spans on a period of 2 years as per protocol. The clinical trial in which phase? So the clinical trial here they are asking is about phase three, because in phase three the volunteers are around 1500, that is above 1,000 volunteers to 5,000 volunteers are tested in phase 3. Then GPAT 2016, next question was, efficacy of drug is checked in modest population. So here the question is of efficacy, but in a modest population. So that will be the clinical trial phase 2 will be the correct answer. So like this, in GPAT 2016, there were two questions from clinical trials, as well as in GPAT 17, 18, as well as in 20, as well as in GPAT 14 also, there was question on phase zero studies. So as you can see, the question or the concept has been repeated. Phase zero studies was asked in GPAT 2014 also, as well as in 2017 also. So the 2014 GPAT question states that the phase zero studies is, and the options, the points were exploratory investigational new drug study, human microdosing study, step to speed up drug discovery development process, and S is the mandatory by FDA. So the correct option will be PQR, as it is an exploratory investigational new drug study. As I mentioned, before starting the clinical trials, when there is an investigational new drug, companies can opt for the phase zero study to know the pharmacokinetics of the investigational new drug. Then it is also called as a human microdosing, because in a minute dose, these are new drug is been tested in a human volunteer population, and it is a step to speed up drug discovery and development process to know whether our drug, new drug, will be effective and will pass the phases of the clinical trials. And it is not mandatory by FDA. So S won't be the correct answer, as phase 0 is not mandatory by FDA. So the correct answer will be PQR. So like this, every year GPAT they try to ask a question on clinical trials and their concepts. So please remember these basics concepts. We will revise clinical trials. There are four phases: 1, 2, 3, 4. In first phase, it is we check a maximum tolerable dose. In phase 2, we check therapeutic efficacy. In phase 3, we confirm that therapeutic efficacy. And in phase 4, is a post-marketing surveillance to know the adverse drug reactions. And phase 0, which is a microdosing studies, is conducted prior to phase 1 if company wants. So these were the questions which we saw. Then after seeing the clinical trials, now the question appears, why we do the clinical trials? So there are different types of drug applications introduced by US FDA. To analyze those drug applications, those new drugs, there are clinical trials. So there are three types of primary drug applications. So first one is investigational new drug application, which is also called as IND. In investigational new drug application, there are three types: investigator IND, emergency IND, and treatment IND. Now, what is investigational new drug application? This application is used for unapproved drug which are introduced for first time. So these are investigational new drug applications. So in first case, in first scenario where investigator IND is filed, at that time investigational drug is analyzed. When emergency IND is filed, in emergency IND is filed when drugs which are being assessed is for emergency situation. So what is the example of this emergency IND? So if there is a new drug, if there is an investigational new drug which is being tried to, which is being analyzed for COVID-19 situation, as COVID-19 situation is an emergency situation. So if there is any investigational new drug which is being tested for COVID-19, then the US FDA will grant it under emergency IND, and the companies will file this IND under emergency IND application, which is a in an emergency situation, drugs which are being tested for emergency situations. The third situation, which is treatment IND. Now, treatment IND are for the drugs for the life-threatening conditions. So drugs which treat the life-threatening conditions are being filed in a treatment IND. So this is the basic classification of investigational new drug applications. So investigational new drug applications are basically used for filing the unapproved drug and conducting their tests. So there are three types: investigator, which is investigational drug, emergency IND, drugs which are being tested for emergency situations like COVID-19, treatment IND, where drugs are being tested for life-threatening conditions. Now the second point is new drug application, which we saw previously, that is new drug. So when there is a new drug which is being produced by any company and they want to get approval through US FDA, they file that new drug by new drug application. Now the third point is abbreviated new drug application, which is also called as ANDA, and it is for the generic medicines. So when the new drug application get expired, after expiry, the other companies can enter the same market, market the same medicine under the generic medicines name or under the ANDA application, that is abbreviated new drug application. So this is the basic concept, basic difference between the new drug, which is an innovator drug where the company for first time they introduce that drug into the market, and abbreviated drug. So when the innovator drug patent gets expired, other companies are allowed to enter into that same market to produce the same drug, same medication, but under the generic medicine category, which is abbreviated new drug application. So now let's see one question from the same concept in GPAT 2015. There was a question from the same concept, that is, a pharmaceutical company plans to market a generic version of a drug whose patent has been expired. which type of documentation must be submitted to FDA. And as we correctly explained in a previous slide, that would be ANDA, that is abbreviated new drug application. It is an application which is submitted to get approval for generic version of drug. So always remember, ANDA for generic version of drug, new drug application for innovator drug, IND, which is an investigational new drug application, and SNDA, which is a subsequent new drug application. If there is any modification in the new drug application, then the companies can file SNDA, that is subsequent new drug application. So this was about three different types of drug applications which a company has to file if they want to get an approval through US FDA. Now let's see what are exactly new drugs. So there are five basic criteria in where we can say that the molecule or the drug is a new drug. So the first one is that when there is an active API or active pharmaceutical ingredient or a phytopharmaceutical drug, which is a drug which is not being used in any country, in the country, then that drug is called as a new drug. So when a drug is not being used in a country, it is called as a new drug. So that is the first point. Then the second criteria is when drug is with modified or new claims, including the indications, route of administrations, dose and dosage forms. So there are modified claims of the same existing drug, then also that drug is called as a new drug. The third point is when a company introduces a fixed dose combination. Fixed dose combination, which is also called as FDC, it's basically combination of two or more drugs in a fixed proportion. So therefore it is called as a fixed dose combination. So when the fixed dose combination is introduced for the first time, or else there is a modified claims on the existing FDCs, then also that medication is called as a new drug. Then the fourth criteria is modified or sustained release dosage forms. When a company introduces a modified or sustained release or a novel drug delivery systems, then also that criteria or that medications are considered as a new drug. And the last and the fifth criteria for new drugs is that when there is a medication, when there is a vaccine, when there is a recombinant DNA technology, recombinant derived products, when there is a drug related to living or modified organisms or monoclonal antibodies, stem cell derived products, gene therapeutic products or xenografts. So all these criteria come under the new drug application title, or they are called as a new drugs. So there are five important criteria for calling any medication a new drug. First one, it is not been used in the country. Second, there are modified or new claims for the existing medication. If there is a FDC, then fourth is if there is a modified or sustained release dosage form or a novel drug delivery system. And the fifth one is if there is a vaccine, if the medication is vaccine, monoclonal antibody, RDNA technology, stem cell derived product or gene therapeutic products. So these are five important criteria which everyone should know. So this was all about the new drug. Now moving to generic drugs. So first we saw the new drug, the innovator drugs. Now we will see what's the concept of generic drugs as per the US FDA. So US FDA was the first regulatory body which introduced the concept of generic drug. And they stated that a generic drug is a medication created to be the same as an already marketed brand name drug. Here the brand name drug means the innovator drug. Here it means innovator drug. The drug which was brought for the first time in the market by the innovator company is the brand name drug. So when the generic drugs can come into the market after expiry of the patent of the innovator medicine or innovator drug, the other companies has a right to enter into the market by producing the same medication. So it's very important. It should be same in the context of dosage form, in the context of strength, route of administration, quality, performance characteristics, and intended use. All these six criteria should be fulfilled by the generic drugs. So let's just revise. A generic drug is a medication created to be same as an already marketed brand name in dosage form, strength, route of administration, quality, performance characteristics, and intended use. So when the drug will be same in all these aspects, then only that drug will be called as a generic drug. So in short, what is a generic drug? So generic drugs are basically pharmaceutically equivalent, bioequivalent, and therapeutic equivalent with innovator drug. So basically, these three parameters are most important. Generic drug should be pharmaceutically equivalent, means that they should have similar dosage form, similar strength, similar route of administration. They should be bioequivalent, means their bioavailability should match with the innovator drug. And the third point, it should be therapeutically equivalent, means they should show the similar clinical efficacy as that of the innovator branded drug. Then only those drugs will be approved as a generic drugs. And this is the concept which was introduced by the US FDA, which is the accurate concept of the generic drugs. Then moving to the regulatory requirements by US FDA. So when the US FDA asks, what are the requirements for approving the ANDA, which is a new drug, NDA, which is a new drug, and ANDA, which is a generic drug. So for new drug, the company has to submit the information regarding chemistry manufacturing control, which is also called as, these three points are also called as CMC. Chemistry means the structural activity relationship, all the medicinal chemistry aspect of the drug, new drug. Manufacturing, that is how the drug is being manufactured, API synthesis, how the dosage form is being manufactured. Third, controls, means what are the control parameters, what are the limits, what are the evaluation parameters. So that all information comes under CMC, chemistry manufacturing controls. After that, the innovator company also has to submit labeling and testing parameters, testing results to the US FDA for getting approval. And the most important point for any NDA, for any new drug application, they should comply and they should qualify all the three: animal studies, clinical studies, and bioavailability studies. Clinical studies, all the three clinical studies, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and after approving ANDA, phase 4. All these clinical studies should be complied and should be qualified by the new drug application. Then only US FDA grants the approval for the new drug, as well as the bioavailability studies. But in the case of ANDA, which is also called as a generic drugs, the requirement is of only of chemistry, manufacturing, control, labeling, testing, which is same as that of new drug. Here exception is that here, rather than conducting the whole clinical study starting from phase 1 to phase 0, the ANDA has to only conduct bioequivalent study, which is a only test, only bio evaluation parameter which US FDA asks for any generic manufacturing company to get complied. So what is bioequivalent study? That we will see in the next slide. So this is the key difference between generic drug and the ANDA or a brand name drug. In generic drug, they don't have to perform all the animal studies and clinical studies. They just have to perform the bioequivalent study. And once the generic drug is bioequivalent, that means it has the same bioavailability as that of the branded drug. It means that it will have a similar clinical efficacy, and thus the US FDA can grant the approval for the generic drugs. And that's why the clinical studies are not being performed for ANDA, these ANDAs are economic, and that's the reason why they are low cost. Now moving to what are bioequivalence testing. As we saw in the previous slide, for generic drug, it is compulsory by US FDA to conduct bioequivalence studies and to submit the bioequivalence data. So what are bioequivalence studies? So here, first of all, we have to check the amount of drug reaching into blood, which is also called as bioavailability. How much drug is reached into the blood after administering the drug or administering the medication, that is checked. And here for our bioavailability, AUC, that is area under curve, or Cmax, such parameters are analyzed for determining the bioavailability. Now in bioavailability, in bioequivalence study, there are minimum 24 human healthy volunteers are taken, and that 24 human healthy volunteers are analyzed for innovator formulation as well as for generic medicine formulation. So there is a group of 12-12. So for one group, the innovator brand formulation is being administered. For another group, the generic medicines are administered, and both the generic medicine group and the innovative formulation group are tested for the bioavailability. And once the generic medicine test shows the bioavailability between the 80 to 125% as that of innovator brand with 90% confidence interval, it is said that it is bioequivalent. That means the generic drug passes the bioequivalence test. Now, what is 80 to 125%? So for bioavailability, it means that our generic medicine should be should show the amount of drug reaching into blood about 80% or 125% as compared to our innovator brand. So if innovator brand shows 100% bioavailability, then our generic medicine should show 80% to 125% bioavailability. That is the range given by US FDA. So this was about bioequivalence. Now moving to few important definitions as per the which are related to the new drug application or bioequivalence or the ANDA. The first terminology is of pharmaceutical equivalence. So as we already discussed, pharmaceutical equivalent means medicines, two or more medicines having same API, same active pharmaceutical ingredient, same strength, dosage form, route of administration, as well as indication. So all the physical parameters like API, strength, dosage form, route of administration, as well as indication, all the in vitro parameters should be same. It means that then the medicine will be called as pharmaceutical equivalent. Now, what is bioequivalent? When two or more medicines show similar bioavailability, which we discussed in a previous slide, when they show similar bioavailability in the range of 80 to 125%, then they are called as bioequivalent. Now, what are therapeutic equivalents? So when there are two or more medicines which show same clinical effect and safety profile. So when it show the same clinical effect and safety profile, then those medicines are called as therapeutic equivalent. So please note down these key differences between what is pharmaceutical equivalent, which have same API, strength, dosage form, route of administration and indication, bioequivalent, which have similar bioavailability, therapeutic equivalent, which have same clinical effect and safety profile. So these were the three important parameters, and all these three important parameters should be seen in an ANDA, which is called as a generic drug. So all the generic drugs should have pharmaceutical equivalency, bioequivalency and therapeutic equivalency as that of innovator drug. Now the fourth terminology is pharmaceutical alternative. So pharmaceutical alternative means same active moiety, but that may differ in chemical form. So as the active moiety is same, but there are different chemical forms like salt hai, ester hai, of the same active compound is called as pharmaceutical alternative. So example, there is metformin hydrochloride, metformin esterase, or any other drug. So as metformin hydrochloride is a one form, hydrochloride is a salt, as well as metformin citrate, if we say then citrate is this another ester form of the metformin. So likewise, if the, but the metformin is the same active moiety. So if it has the same active moiety but different chemical forms, then it is called as pharmaceutical alternative. Now therapeutic alternative. Therapeutic alternative means a drug which differs chemically from one prescribed form but provides same effect. So when there are two or different chemical form, there are two or different drugs which are having same clinical efficacy, same therapeutic efficacy, same therapeutic effect, then it is called as therapeutic alternatives. Both are different drugs but shows same therapeutic effect. So that is therapeutic alternatives. So these are key important definitions. Based upon this concept, there were few questions in recent years in GPAT. In GPAT 2020 as well as in GPAT 2017, the same question was repeated and the same concept was repeated of pharmaceutical alternative. The question was like this: drug products that contain the same therapeutic moiety but different salts. So please remember, same therapeutic moiety but different salts, esters and complexes are called as pharmaceutical alternative, as we saw in the previous slide. In GPAT 2019, the question was on the similar lines: when two brands of drug product gives same clinical results, so it will termed as a therapeutic equivalency. So based upon the same concept, the questions were asked in 2017 as well as in 2019 in GPAT. So that's why these concepts are very important. So this was all for the day. So in the fifth session, we saw various aspects of clinical trials. So we will just revise what we saw in the fifth session. So in fifth session, we saw about clinical trials, different phases of clinical trials, its purpose and significance of clinical trials, and about the microdosing, which is a phase zero. We saw that each and every year, they are trying to ask one question from clinical trials, starting from 2018, 16, 17, and GPA 2014 also, there was question on clinical trials. Then we saw different types of drug applications, what is called as IND, Investigational New Drug, NDA, New Drug, and Abbreviated New Drug Application. We saw that on this aspect also, there was question in GPA 2015. Then we saw what are new drugs and what are the different criteria when a medication is termed as a new drug. Then we saw what's the ideal concept and the correct concept of the generic drugs, which was introduced by the US FDA. A generic drug should be pharmaceutical equivalent, bioequivalent, as well as therapeutic equivalent with the innovator drug. Now, what are the regulatory requirements by US FDA? And the bioequivalence testing, how the bioequivalence testing is carried out, and the limit, which is 80 to 125%, which a generic medicine should comply with the innovator brand. Then we saw the five important terminologies: pharmaceutical equivalent, bioequivalent, therapeutic equivalent, what is called as pharmaceutical alternative, and therapeutic alternative. Based upon that, there were few questions in previous GPAT papers like 2017 and 19 on the same lines. So this was all for the GPAT 5th session. If you like this session, if you love this session, please subscribe to our channel, which is Pharmascopy by Kaustubh Pawar, as well as log into the Instagram and subscribe and follow my page, where I put various questions and various important topics related to GPAT and other competitive exams. So I hope you like my session. So this is all for the today. Thank you.